Hello and welcome to Studio 41 presented by Chime. My name is Bobby Corella, digital content manager for the Dallas Mavericks. Joined today by a very special guest, an international celebrity, famous author Thomas Pletzinger, author of The Great Nowitzki, Basketball and the Meaning of Life, an awesome book about Dirk, our basketball hero, certainly my basketball hero too. Thomas, how you doing?
I'm doing okay. I'm happy to be here.
Sounded like you said good at first, and then you changed it to okay. Was that a bad intro?
No, you know, some understatement is always good. No, I'm good. I'm great.
Oh, that's good. That's good. It was a very German thing. It's a very German thing. I'm okay. I'm just okay.
Yeah, I know. I know. But and I have big things ahead today. Since we're presenting a book, I'm you know, excited.
Yeah.
I'm great.
Awesome. Well, that's very exciting stuff. So, Basketball and the Meaning of Life. The book is fantastic. It's available everywhere you can get a book. Like Thomas was saying, later tonight, actually, there's going to be an event with Dirk, so it's going to be really cool. But Basketball and the Meaning of Life, there's a lot in that title. We'll talk about the basketball in a bit, but what about the meaning of life? What is the meaning of life in this book?
That's a simple question to start. you know, the book was called differently in Germany, and I think they wanted to bang the drum a little more, be a little louder and bigger here. And it makes sense, because my impression when I wrote that book and watched Dirk at work was that I could learn something or understand something about life in general. And I think people can take something away from watching Dirk at work and the way he handles himself. I think there is something in this book that gives you a clue to what it could be, the meaning of life. Of course, I don't know. I mean, I'm not the first to think about this, and I won't be the last. So,
Well, it's a good approach, though. So the book is basically just a series of vignettes. Thomas followed around Dirk for years. I mean, 7 years, I think, eight years before this book was finally released. So there's a whole lot in here, history, observing really intimate moments that no one else has seen, like Dirk's workouts in the summer with Holger, things like that. And I think the striking thing about those workout sessions, obviously it's physical exertion. He's practicing basketball, doing cool fingertip push-ups and walking around the floor on his bare hands, is that there was this mental exercise as well. And so it's almost like, with Dirk and Holger, is basketball like secondary? It really feels like their relationship and the way that Holger, his methodology, the way that he teaches Dirk and the way that Dirk approaches the game, it almost feels like basketball is kind of like the physical thing, but that it's really up here is what's going on between them.
I think it's a combination of both, of course. When they work out, I mean, the physical stuff is really important. Also, the technical stuff matters a lot, you know, the angles, how high is the arc of the ball, the angle the ball hits the basket. You know, these things are important. Practice is important. Repetition is important. But the other aspect, freedom is also important, and fun is very important. And thinking outside the box, or sometimes even relaxing and not thinking about basketball, is also really important to be successful in basketball, at least for Dirk, and that's something that I saw when I watched him. There's the mental aspect, of course. I think you guys talked about this in the book club. You know, always be able to play out little scenarios, always think about things ahead, you know, couple days, couple weeks, couple months, couple years, maybe, before they happen, and you've already done that in your head. These things are very important to Dirk's success, I would think. But also, and that's the last part of the answer, to his well-being, I would say. You know, focus, concentration, all these things play a really important role, and also happiness, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, that the mental side of basketball is just as important as the physical. Even on the floor, like, you have to be prepared for everything. You have to know all the steps and everything. But the most, like, the quote from the book that stands out to me the most is actually talking to Holger. So the book generally is sort of about Dirk, but it's a lot about Holger. I would even say it's more about Holger and Ernie Butler and kind of everybody around Dirk that made Dirk Dirk. So it's not a traditional biography about Dirk. And there's this sort of meta commentary, I guess, portion of the book where there's a scene where you're just getting coffee with Holger. And I call
right
it
in the
scene.
Beginning?
Yeah, right in the beginning, like page 39 or page 40 or something, where y'all are hanging out at a coffee shop and you're pitching Holger, like, I want to write this book about Dirk. And Holger's like, I mean, like, I don't think that's a good idea because Dirk's not really going to tell you too much about himself. And it's not because he is this private guy. Dirk is a private guy. But it's also because Holger goes into, like, this long Nietzsche quote that I'm sure Dirk is familiar with, too. Like, how many basketball players read Friedrich Nietzsche? But about, like, guarding your true self. Because once you communicate to people who you really are, like, you're not really that person anymore. Yeah. So there's this really kind of very intentional guard that Dirk keeps up and that Holger keeps up around him. And so I think that, that was as large a reason as any that the book really isn't about Dirk, because no one can really write a book about Dirk.
Yeah, and maybe he could try to write one himself. But I think it's not the point who someone really is. And I think Holger, in the beginning, that first meeting was really, really interesting. You know, that was the first time I met him, and he just tested, who is that guy? Why is he interested? What's his motive? What's his, what's his background? So I walked into that coffee shop on Mockingbird, and for, I don't know, an hour, 1.5 hours, he just checked and tested and maybe even playfully provoked me. And I felt like I was applying to an internship, which it makes sense. He wanted to see how I behaved. What anecdotes did I tell? What did I present from my own experience? You know, and basically I was not expecting this. I was just there because I wanted to write an article. You know, in the very beginning.
Mm-hmm. This is 2012 that we're talking.
Yeah, exactly.
About,
this morning actually I thought about it. It was I'll loop back later to your question, but. This morning I thought about, it was almost exactly 10 years ago that this particular day happened. It was the playoff, it was the 2012 playoff. And I traveled here to write a piece, a magazine piece on Dirk Nowitzki. And I run into this guy who actually wants to know what I'm all about. And, it was so interesting, and he fires Nietzsche at me, and he fires Thomas Nagel at me, and
he just had that bat philosophy of a bat thing just in his back pocket. He pulled that out of thin air.
Yeah, no, I don't know if it's probably one of the books that he had read recently, and it makes sense. It makes sense. I asked him. I think he said, I don't want to discourage you. And I'm like, maybe you're doing this and you're discouraging me. But that was a test. So in the end, I wasn't discouraged enough. Mm. And I still wrote a book. And back to your question, to write about someone, and, you know, I, as a writer, don't have the illusion that I can actually get to the core. I mean, you talked about this in the book club. There's different versions of every story. So, and everyone has a different perception of Dirk. And I'm sure this perception that Dirk has of himself varies from the one that I have of him. And I mean, it's a philosophical question, of course. But I guess my approach was best way I could go about it, and encircle him, and see, you know, what the people around him behave like, what they think about, what they talk about, how they work. So yeah, that was my approach, and this interesting first meeting set the tone, I would say.
And you even say that the more you got to know about Holger, the more you heard about Holger, like, you're not even sure what's true and what's not.
Because in the best sense of the word, he's a storyteller. You know, he tells you great stories. It's really entertaining and smart, and he's a storyteller. So, and that's the fun part about this. And in the book is one anecdote where turns out it's a story. I don't want to give away too much, but he's still sitting there. He's still talking to us. So, yeah.
I believe everything that man says.
Yeah, you can believe it because he never says he's right. He always doubts himself too. You know, as a fun sport, you know, he always thinks, okay, maybe things are different. Mm-hmm. Let's think about it. It's exciting to think about things. So that's Holger.
I mean, that partly kind of led to Dirk anyway, looking at something that everybody knows in basketball and thinking about it in a different way.
Yeah, yeah.
But you were not a basketball guy. I mean, you like basketball. There's a whole section in this book about your experience with basketball, your relationship with the sport before Dirk was Dirk. You know, even before Dirk was kind of before Dirk was alive, before he was able to be a pro, certainly.
I mean, I'm a couple of years older than he is. Yeah. I was born in 75. He was born in 78.
Before he's on the scene, I mean, you know, whenever he's still just a kid.
Yeah.
You're a writer, first and foremost. Very successful book that is now a series, which is awesome, too. But I say all of that to say, like, you're not just some basketball dude that wrote a book about a basketball dude, you know. So what is it about Dirk that made you want to write about him? You kind of get into it in the book and also just your connection with basketball and everything. But why Dirk and why at that moment in time?
Well, I spent my childhood and youth in the gym. You know, I grew up in a small city in Western Germany. And the sport that we played was basketball. That was a first division club. We didn't have a soccer club. Soccer is really important in Germany, so we didn't have a soccer club in our town in the upper leagues. It was like fourth division soccer or so. So basketball was a sport, and I always hoped that I could one day maybe play in the pros. And you know, looking back, I could have said with 14 years old or so, this is not something that's in my future. But
you had
the
height, though. You did have the height.
Yeah, but I didn't have the talent. So and I also thought about the game in the wrong way. I would say, looking back, you know, having had that experience with Dirk, I looked at the game always in narrative terms. Like I saw a basketball game as a narrative arc. You know what I mean? So when I missed two shots, I always thought, okay, what's going to happen next? I'm probably going to miss the next shot too. And when I missed three shots, I looked back and said, you know, it's a bad game. And a good basketball player doesn't do that. Mm-hmm. They keep shooting, they keep playing, and I didn't. I couldn't. I was too hung up in that. You know, what story does the basketball game tell me? And there's no way I can. Change the outcome if I started bad, for example, you know.
But that also means that if you get off to a good start, then I mean you're going for 50.
Yeah, then that's also something that Dirk probably doesn't do. If he doesn't believe he's going to score 50 if he scored the first four baskets, he believed he thought about the game in a different way. So I didn't. So I stopped. I stopped playing when I was, you know, 17 years or so, 17 years old. I stopped playing serious basketball. I played for fun, and I ended my career when I was 24, 25. But by then, I was already I got an MA in American Studies and an MFA. So I was already becoming a writer. And I have to say, that's the area, that's the field I'm better at than at playing basketball. So wrote a first novel, and after my first novel was published, I wanted to write a second one, and you know, sort of had a writer's block for a couple of months. I didn't like what I was doing, so my editor said, you know, what is there something? Is there something else? Can you do something else for a year? And I thought about it, went back to my childhood, to my playing basketball, and realized, you know, there's never been a good book about German basketball. So I wrote a book on German basketball. I was embedded with Alba Berlin for an entire season, on the bus, in the locker room, everywhere. And I wrote a book on that, which was a first, because there was never a a book on German basketball before of that, with that approach, with that narrative approach. So I put my skills, my writing skills, and applied them to the field of basketball. So basically, I found my niche, I would say, and because I found that niche, and because Dirk is so big in Germany, as a figure, but also as a basketball player and as a character, as a figure, that was the best thing I could do. You know, that was the most interesting topic. So that led me to writing about Dirk. But basically, I'm just another basketball dude writing about
basketball. No, you're not a basketball dude. You're not just a basketball dude. Yeah. You're writing about that dude. Mm-hmm. You know, you're writing about the basketball dude.
Yeah.
I think it's really interesting, and obviously this wasn't your choice. It just kind of is the way it played out. But this book is kind of written about Dirk at the end. Like, we think of books written about heroic figures or titans of their industry as, like, chronicling their up.
Yes.
You know, everyone likes the come up, you know, and then everyone likes whenever they're at their peak. But, you know, your first interaction with Dirk didn't really even happen because they went down 3-0 or they got swept against the Thunder, and it was kind of a big bummer. And that, unbeknownst to us at the time, was kind of signaling the end for the Mavs as we knew them. You know, they were 11 straight 50-win seasons. They wouldn't even make the playoffs in 2013, and then, you know, the rebuild would come a couple years after.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's just really interesting that this book was written at a time whenever he'd already been to the mountaintop and kind of was coming down, and then reality set in. Like, he knew that not only was he on the way down, but, like, the end is near.
Mm-hmm.
And
you
don't normally see that story told.
Yeah, because people always believe the interesting part is the path to the mountaintop. But I'm convinced that, you know, coming down from the mountain is also interesting to people because everyone's getting older. That's an experience everyone makes, so people can relate to that too. And of course, there is the path to the mountaintop in the book. I'm not just writing about the
last. Yeah, it's not just 37-year-old Dirk. You know,
yeah, and so I'm basically the book. It tells my years with Dirk Nowitzki from 2012 until the very last games. But while I'm telling that story, that following that arc, I'm also going back to 2011 or to the very early days, talking about how Dirk became Dirk. So, yeah, but I honestly think aging and dealing with age has a certain grace, or can have a certain grace, and that's why I'm interested in that.
Mm-hmm.
And I realize it's probably an unusual approach, but I thought it was a very interesting approach too.
Well, so I think it's a kind of a tribute to Dirk himself too, that, like, you're not in the gym with him when he's 23 years old, you're in the gym with him when he's, like, 33 or 34, 35, 36. And again, even though he understands that he's not who he once was, like, the workouts are still just as intense, you know, and maybe even now that he's won a championship in this book and now that he is kind of this global superstar, his off-court responsibilities have kind of increased too. There's scenes where he's shooting commercials that he isn't super enthused about. You know, I mean, like, there's a lot of responsibilities in his life. And so I think there is something very unique about kind of the timing of this whole thing.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's also nice that, you know, coming into this project, I thought, okay, you know, at first I thought it was a magazine piece. And then it turned into another magazine piece and another one. And only then did we decide to do a book, and then it was. I mean, in a way, it was horrible, because then he signed another 1-year contract, and then I was already at 3 years working on this thing. And I remember my wife walking into my studio one morning, and she looked at me and said, "Did you hear?" And I said, "No, what happened? What happened?" She said, "He signed another 2-year contract." and that basically meant that I would have to go for another...
Yeah, you get to hang out with us for another 2 years.
Yeah.
Lucky you.
You weren't even here in the beginning.
That's true. I met you, like, late. Yeah, I met you late in the game.
Yeah.
But you spent a lot of time here. Yeah. I mean, Dallas kind of became... You know, it's not like you're just popping over to Dallas for, like, one day and then leaving. I mean, you were here for, like, weeks and weeks at a time. It almost became your second home.
I traveled a lot. Like I came here, I don't know, I didn't count, but it must have been like 25, 30, 35 times or so over the course of several years. But I also traveled to China with Derek, or to Poland, or to Slovenia, in Germany, you know, always going to his charity events or to his practices in the summer. So it was a lot of traveling involved and a lot of spending time, a lot of, you know, watching, taking notes. I have so many notebooks filled because I expected it to be shorter. And then, it amounted to a giant project. And, you know, I'm still convinced that it's good that I spent all those months and years. Because at one point you realize the good things, the interesting things don't happen, or you don't see them if you see things only once.
Mm-hmm. So
you have to wait, and you know the stage situation disappears. Like it has to become normal that you're there. Then you see the real stuff.
Yeah, yeah. If you want to be the fly on the wall, you got to be. I mean, you got
to
be in the room.
Yeah,
for
you
a
have
while
to be
first.
A fly. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. I mean, you kind of are. It's called the Great Nowitzki. I'm sure that's intentional too. But you're kind of the Nick Caraway to Dirk's Gatsby.
Yeah, you know, of course. The whole setup or the structure of the book or the yeah. It obviously it's a reference to Fitzgerald's book.
Has Dirk ever read that book? Do you know?
I think he's watched the movie.
Okay.
No,
do you think he would consider himself like a Leo DiCaprio type, or do you think he would say?
I think he's definitely taller than DiCaprio.
That's
right?
True. Yeah. Leo's probably like 5'7".
But I always like this idea to have the narrator of the book be a first person narrator, because it's subjective. It can be subjective. Can be interesting, more interesting, and then looking at someone who is Gatsby's always in that giant villa, and Caraway is living down. Stairs in the tea salon, or what is it?
Nicer digs than Nick Caraway, but yeah, so, in the little gardener's house.
Yeah, yeah. So he lives there, and then at one point, he's invited to have tea, and then he gets sucked into the life of Gatsby and his people. And I always thought it would be interesting, especially because it's an American story, a German American story. Yeah, but
has a happier ending. This book has a happier ending.
Yeah. That's why I thought maybe the title isn't right. But it, then I said, yeah, I don't care. I think it's the right title. It's also tongue in cheek. Can you say that?
Yeah,
a little bit ironic. And I like the story that when Dirk got the book and he wanted to read it, he took the cover off because he was embarrassed to read a book that, to be seen reading a book called The Great Nowitzki. I like the story. It tells a lot about who he is, right?
Absolutely does. And kind of reinforces the whole, one of the themes of the book to me is like, this guy is whoever you want him to be. I mean, he's almost a mirror. Like your relationship with Dirk, my relationship with Dirk, Everyone in here's relationship with Dirk, everyone who's watching this is different depending on when you first kind of heard about him, or if you know him, or if you've seen him play basketball before. Maybe you haven't. I'm sure there's someone that's read this book that has never watched Dirk dribble a ball one time.
You know, my thesis advisor in Germany she's a professor of American studies. Bettina Friedl is her name, and she said, I read the book. I really like the book, and I don't know anything about baseball. and I thought this was hilarious.
Studies, she doesn't even know basketball or baseball. Come on. What are they studying over there?
So she liked the book. I mean, she liked the character. She liked the storytelling, of course. I think she misspoke, but
yeah.
I always tell a story like this.
Yeah.
And there is something that is not basketball specific, I would say.
Mm.
It's more Nowitzki specific.
And the meaning of life too.
Yeah.
So can you explain as best you can what the seven levels of consciousness are? Because I've talked to you about this before. I read about it in the book. I still don't really get it, but there's this
it's
higher state of being that does understand this. This
I
concept.
Mean, then, I think Dirk and Holger developed this system of the stages the career can develop in. Holger told me that he actually wrote letters to himself, put them in sealed envelopes, as not, you know, to be opened later in the career, so in order not to lie to himself. So he wanted to check at later stages what he thought was good, was going to be good, and right, and what the outcome was. But he said people tend to lie to themselves and say, you know, it didn't happen because, and he wanted to, can you say, not compromise himself?
Mm-hmm.
Can you say that?
Stay true to himself, yeah. I guess. You know.
So he wanted these messages to himself to be there and to be read by him, and he wanted them to be true and not written by somebody else. So he did the seven. I think he said the seven stages, and I think those were physical, technical, but they're also mental. Meaning, at one point you can be at a certain level in Dirk's career. Dirk was going to be mentally prepared for his opponents. Meaning, they would know that he would know what he would do.
He's going to do something.
Because they will have watched film.
Yeah.
And they will know when he has the ball in his right hand, and you know, then this and that might happen, very likely. And then he would come up with a solution to that. So his opponent would know what he was going to do, but he would know that the opponent would know what he was going to do, blah, blah, and so on and so forth. And at one point, Dirk would have to be the person to decide. And the other person, his opponent, would be the one who knows that everything can happen and he has no idea what's going to happen. And that is the mental advantage that Dirk was going to have.
So he becomes like an Ubermensch or something?
Yeah, in a basketball sense, he would be better prepared. I think I tried to get this across when he scored on point 30,000, mm-hmm. When he has only one player playing against him. It's one-on-one, basically. Larry Nance Jr., I think, and I try to, you know, describe this scene as to illustrate how that works. So he would know, and these are all aspects of Dirk's success, I would say, and how they thought about the game. Yeah.
And mastering those things, I mean, I guess that goes back to the meaning of life. No matter what you do, if you're an accountant, for example, like former Mav Ryan Brokoff, or if you're a basketball player, whatever. If you're prepared, then it doesn't matter what the other people are doing.
Yeah.
Like, Dirk made, you know, the game winner in game two of the finals. There was no fancy move. He just spun and went and laid it in lefty over, like, a Hall of Famer in Chris Bosh. But because
I watched that scene so many times.
And it's so simple.
Yeah.
I mean, the one over Haslam in game four is even more simple. There's no move. He just rips through and goes to his strong hand. But because they're thinking, well, I got to sit back on the pump fake. I got to watch for the other hand. I got to watch for the fade. I got to watch for the stop. And you're thinking about 35 different things, and so you forget about the most obvious, most simple kind of outcome. I guess like you're deconstructing like Occam's razor, kind of.
And it's basically a mental circle, right? Everyone's thinking, and then you do the simple thing, because everyone else is thinking like a tenth of a second too long, and he knows that moment, and he goes in that very moment. I think that's, yeah. That's,
and if you're not the fastest gentleman, like Dirk wasn't, and like Luke
was
not,
it was okay.
You're quick enough. What is the, Kati asked you this, we were talking about this on during the book club as well, but what is, whenever you think about Dirk, what is your Dirk visual in your mind? Is it a game? Is it a moment? Is it a photo? Is it a memory that you have of him, like off the floor? When you think about Dirk, who's this hero, what is your image?
I find it hard to answer this question because I mean there are obviously so many images, so many films, game sequences that I've seen. For some reason, sometimes I like these photos when he comes back after scoring a basketball basket when he comes back and he scored and he comes, you know, keeps yelling or holding up a three, his fingers or, and that's this one when he's bearded and he tucks at his jersey. And for some reason, I find this, I don't know, it looks a bit wild, which is untypical, but I thought, I always think it's nice, that image. There's another one that I find really telling and great. It's a photography as well, a photograph as well, I'm sorry. And that is when he qualifies for the Olympic Games after failing three or four times to do so. And he qualifies for Beijing 2008. And they win the game against Puerto Rico, and he comes.
And his teammate JJ Barea too.
Yeah, yeah. It was a do or die game. The winner would advance to the Olympic Games, and his teammates were celebrating, and he just put a towel over his head, went to the locker room. The locker room was locked, so he sat in front of the locker room until some I think his physio came in or his doctor came in. Unlocked the door and he broke down, and the photographer snuck in and took that picture. Dirk on the stretcher, so happy and so relieved and basically unable to celebrate like the regular basketball player. And this image contains so much for me that I really like it. It's always in my mind. It's in the book too. It's Thilo Wiedensola took that shot, a guy who's always with the German national team. And there's so much in this image. But then, of course, I have lots of nice pictures of Dirk. I've never taken a selfie with him. only when the book came out in Germany, somebody made us on stage made us take a selfie, and I still value that selfie as well. But lots of images.
Yeah. And there's of course in 2011 when they won the championship, he kind of did the same thing, right? He went to the locker room and broke down in there. Do you think in those moments, like,
yes,
it's a tidal wave of relief and everything, and just a complete release of everything. But why do you think? I mean, I get you. This is just pure projection, but why do you think that's the case for him? Why do you think he needs to feel that release? Why do you think that? Is it doubt? Is it happiness? Is it joy? Is it just relief? I mean, is it just it feels like a very complicated thing for that to be a reaction.
But maybe this is the point, as you said earlier, when he's the bat. That we know everything about, but we can't really know why that is. Why does he need to go to the locker room and not do the regular celebrating that the standard celebratory moves? And I don't know. I try to describe it, but I not explain it, but describe it. And both these moments I find really touching, and I think they reflect their reflection of why he cares, or that he cares a lot.
Mm.
And it's in the chapter on pressure, right? There's a long chapter on the pressure and how you deal with pressure. And he says, sometimes you win, sometimes the pressure wins, and sometimes you win. And these moments when he wins against pressure, I find it plausible. I can't fully explain it, though.
Yeah.
You would have to ask him.
But he'll never tell you.
What?
And he'll never tell you. And that's kind of the beautiful thing.
He'll probably tell, he can tell that story. I can't fully explain it.
Yeah. I guess they're just mysteries. Are there any other mysteries? Is there any other, now that you've written a whole book about Dirk, is there anything else about him that you want to know that you don't? Or anything else about people in his life that you want to know? Yeah. Is there any, you're a detective. What is there left to uncover?
I'm sure there are a lot of anecdotes. Such a long career with an international career, so many games played, so many teammates, so many trips, so many plane rides. There's so many things that I couldn't write about, of course. But I thought about this a lot. You know, what happens when you're done with the book? Like, are you still interested in the story, or is that something that, you know, close the cover, that's it? And here I am, 3 years later, and I'm still interested, you know, and I still like to hear that story, because I find it a story that, you know, everyone can take something out of, you know, some, you know. I've never met a person in my professional life, maybe in my entire life, I don't know, who looked at his profession with such care and such detail, and who took it so seriously. And that is something, I think anyone, like a nurse, a teacher, a painter, cab driver, they can, you know, if they ask themselves, you know, is there something I can take away from Dirk's life? I would say that it certainly changed the way I write or the way I work. Looking at him, because he takes it so seriously and he loves it so much, and he never lost he never lost fun. Mm. He still enjoys it
while still maintaining the humility to say, like, this is just putting a basketball through a hoop. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's the most, like,
come on,
humanizing thing of them all. You know. Dude, it's just
it was awesome. Not just putting
it never was, but it was.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It's just so simple, but it's also it's
that's
we'll never
because
understand.
It's so simple. It translates well to everyone's life.
Yeah,
I think
it is an awesome story. It is an awesome story, and it's an awesome book too. The Great Nowitzki.
Thank you very much.
Basketball and the Meaning of Life by Thomas Pletzinger. Thomas, thank you so much for joining us, man. I appreciate it.
Bobby, I really appreciate it. I appreciated the book club, but I also appreciate you actually reading it and talking about it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, no, thank you for joining us. Thank you for watching. Great Nowitzki, Basketball and the Meaning of Life. Go get you a copy. We'll see you.